May come in, sir.
Please come.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
So, how are you ready?
Fine, sir. Thank you.
You are from Kurnool?
Yes, sir.
Kurnool is a very big town?
Yes, sir. Fourth largest town of Andhra.
Fourth largest. And quite near, it's quite near to Bangalore?
Quite near to Hyderabad, sir, basically.
Hyderabad.
Yeah.
And I think highway is leading to Bangalore also.
That is Hyderabad highway, Kurnool comes there.
Yes, yes, I've seen that. Okay. And you studied in Navodaya Vidyalaya.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Tell me something about Navodaya Vidyalayas. When these were established and what was the objective?
So they were started in 1986 to provide quality education to students, especially from rural background with limited economic means, by focusing on holistic development, not just education, but also co-curricular activities, sports, etc.
Okay. Who is the chairman of this? Chairman of Navodaya Vidyalaya?
Navodaya Vidyalaya committee chairman as such is Union Education Minister.
And who is Education Minister now? There is a change.
He was Oil Minister earlier. Dharmendra Pradhan ji, sir.
Pradhan, yes, okay. Okay. You worked in IOC now and working now in State Tax Department.
Yes.
Now, the State Tax Department after GST, what is the status?
We are administering the taxpayers allotted to state. There is a distribution between CGST and SGST. Few are allotted to us and few are allotted to central.
So, you are dealing with the state part of GST?
It's not like that, sir. We are dealing with taxpayers who are allotted to state, both SGST and CGST. Like if you are having 5,000 dealers in Kurnool, 3,000 are allotted to state and 2,000 to central for administration.
It's like this. Actually.
It is like above 5 crore turnover, 50-50 ratio. Below 5 crore turnover, 90 to state and 10 to central.
Okay, you have to take care of all their filing of returns and
yes,
all.
Yes, registration, filing returns, scrutiny of returns. Enforcement can be done by both SGST and CGST.
And this fuel also you look after?
Pardon me.
Fuel tax on petrol and
so
diesel.
That is actually a centralized registration in Vizag. So it is registered in only one circle, that VAT.
So that is not under you?
It is under state government only, but under a single circle.
And liquor?
So liquor, the tax entirely paid by the Breweries Corporation. It is also registered in Vijayawada, central location.
Okay. You see, governments headed by political bosses and they are advised by the bureaucrats. Mostly they go by the advice of bureaucrats. Sometimes they don't agree with the bureaucrats and take their own decisions. So mostly decided by the advised by the bureaucrats and they take decision. But sometimes those decisions cost them very dearly and even result in fall of government or strictures from the Supreme Court. In those situations, what do you think, that bureaucrats should be held responsible for the wrong advice, or they should be punished, or they should not be punished? Example is like hundreds of examples. Governments have fallen many times. Recently, Nagaland government issued orders that all employees, what is that order? You know that?
Pardon me, sir.
You know that what Nagaland government had issued orders? They issued order that all employees should be vaccinated.
Yes, sir.
Huh? And High Court has stayed it. So there may be some situations that it will be very awkward for the government. Mainly because their decisions are based on the advice of bureaucrats.
Sir, the basic strength of Indian bureaucracy is that they can take risks. With that risk comes innovation. So sometimes that may become failures. But ultimately holding bureaucrats or the government bosses responsible will not serve the purpose, because it will deter them from taking risks. So I think rather than focusing on blaming them, I think we should focus on taking timely feedback so that we can restructure them and make them better.
Another issue, very important, lot of encroachments take place at different places. You would be reading in papers, so many encroachments in revenue land, forest land, even on railway stations. So, these encroachments when those are taking place, nobody is bothering. When that reaches a certain critical position or height, then everybody becomes attentive that so much encroachment taking place. Why those encroachments are taking place? Because of laxity on the part of the persons, officers in the field, connivance or political connivance or what? And do you think they should be held accountable for those encroachments? Because after certain, reaching certain stage, it is very difficult to evict the encroachments.
So definitely it is true that to handle the encroachment issue, we need to focus on the root causes, addressing the root causes, like increasing stress on urban infrastructure, unaffordable prices.
No, I am not discussing that.
Yes.
Forget about that. I am telling encroachments mostly take place if the field officers are not attentive or they are conniving or they are, there is pressure from the politicians, okay, let them go for encroachment, don't stop. In that situation, I am telling.
Sir, definitely we need to hold the officers responsible because they will be dealing with issues at the ground level. So they need to do timely inspections, field inspections, etc. So that they can identify such encroachment at an early level. Further, we can also use technology, sir, like the GIS technology. So based on the satellite maps, we can see whether new encroachments have come or not. Based on that, the officers can go to the field and verify that. Rather than officers just going on intelligence or just randomly going, with specific intelligence from the GIS-based software, we can streamline this process. Because there is a vacancy of officers also. Vacancy of officers, especially in the government.
No. There may or may not be.
Yes.
That cannot be the cause.
Yes, that is true.
Andhra is famous for mangoes?
Yes.
Which one?
Bangalampally mangoes from Kurnool itself.
How many mango varieties we have in the country? Any rough idea?
It is like I have read somewhere, it is more than 500 to 600. Sir.
Hmm. And maximum mangoes are produced in which state?
I think Andhra is number one in mango production.
Then other states?
Maharashtra. The next sequence I have.
Can you tell me 2-3 varieties of mangoes other than Banganpalli?
Sir, we have Alfonso, Ratnagiri, these are all.
NDA, which is the government here? NDA government.
National government.
It's NDA or called BJP government?
It is an NDA government, sir. It is a coalition government.
Which are other parties?
Sir, pardon me, sir, I am unable to. Thank you.
Yeah. How do you pronounce your name?
Yashwant.
Yashwant. The Challapalli is initial.
Yes.
C. Yashwant Kumar Reddy. Okay. Yashwant, tell me about your state's position. What is the compensation mechanism provided in the GST law?
Actually, in GST, a revenue growth of 14% is guaranteed.
Hmm. Where it was guaranteed? This 14% is actually where?
The 14% over the previous year's revenue.
Okay.
Previous year's revenue.
Which, where it is said this?
In the GST.
Is it in the Constitution or Compensation Act? Or
it's in the Compensation Act, sir. That is the basic purpose of that. But I think that specific...
14% compensation says state should, if they are not able to get 14% growth of the pre-GST revenue, they will get compensation. Where is it spelled? This particular provision is found where?
Pardon me, I need to look into that. Sir.
Okay, continue. 14%.
14% of revenue is guaranteed.
Mm.
If states are unable to get that, then central will reimburse states from the amount it has collected in the compensation cess that is levied on products like coal, beverages, etc., cigarettes, etc. And that is calculated provisionally in a basis of 2-monthly basis.
Mm.
So it is distributed to states.
So tell me, Andhra, in the general scheme, you have any idea how many states required compensation and how many they didn't require compensation?
That exact number I am not having, sir. But regarding Andhra, Andhra has in took compensation says for the first 3 years. The growth rate was more than 14%.
But only this compensation only for 3 years only, no?
5 years.
5 years.
So 100% compensation for the first 3 years. After that, 75% for the fourth year. Then it gets reduced to 50%.
And then?
And then it was not spoken, sir. Recently, in the 43rd GST Council, a decision was made that in a separate meeting will be held to discuss upon whether to continue this cess or not.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So first 3 years you didn't require compensation. Then
recently the last year 2020-21 financial year we had compensation of around 2,500 crores.
Mm. There is some basic underlying flaw in this compensation. Can you, as a common man, can you think of any this flaw?
Yes, sir. Definitely, if states are assured that their revenues will be guaranteed, then the taxation performance, like increasing the tax base, reducing tax evasion, states will not focus that much on that.
Then what else is the flaw? Government has not anticipated something, right?
It's a situation like pandemic which it has seen, and reduction in the compensation cess collections itself. And when the cess collections are not up to the level they have expected, then what to do? Who will compensate?
Yes.
Whether they need to compensate or not? Those are the questions.
So, how do you see this? To that extent, there is a the policy formulation failed, right?
Even the central government, the Honorable Finance Minister told that it is an act of God and they are not responsible. But states are that that is a constitutional guarantee you have given. And in that so there was no provision.
Saying constitutional guarantee. Now you got where it is etched in? At 14%?
Pardon, I'm unable to remember the specific thing. But it was a constitutional guarantee.
It is in constitution. Okay.
I think a middle approach should be followed, sir, because it is not in the hands of both center and state. So states also should not force for 14% revenue growth, because in this pandemic that is very impossible.
So what is the GST collection up to in the month of July?
In the month of July, it is 92,000 crores.
GST collection July? So July or June?
Sir, July, the numbers are not out yet. The so June numbers are 92,000 crores. July, I need to look today, sir. Yesterday it was completed.
July is 1.16 lakh crores. Just now we got it.
Here.
Okay. Good. So you were there earlier also, pre GST also? No.
No. No. I joined after GST in 2018.
Okay. And do you agree with the principle of sharing of taxpayers between state and center? The 50-50 more than 5 crores and 90-10 less than 5 crores.
As such, I think it is a good mechanism itself, sir, because with the collective enforcement of both center and state, there is more scrutiny. So there is good.
But don't you think it is a disproportionate this thing on below 5 crores? Why 90% should go to state and 10% only should come to center?
It was because of earlier in the VAT regime, the number of taxpayers with goods they were more. But number of taxpayers registered in services, they are less. So the manpower available with center is very less than compared to the manpower with state. So because of that, that was made. But now the all the new registrations, they are divided in 50-50 basis.
All new.
Yeah,
right.
All new.
Right. Good. And one more thing I wanted to ask GST, because you are so fast and vibrant, I forgot. Very nice. Okay. Good, good. So, e-way bills.
Yes.
So, tell me something about e-way bills.
Sir, e-way bill is a document in which details like the vehicle number, the invoice details will be given, and it will have a validity. So that all the transactions above 50,000 will be registered in the network. So, at the end of the month, we can tally whether he has shown all the turnover in his monthly returns. Further, recently there was a very good technological advancement, sir. What they have did is, in toll plazas, they will get the data of vehicles passing. They have integrated that with the EA bill data, vehicle number. Good. So, with that, we can curb the issue of fake ITC based on fake invoice.
What is the level of fake invoice menace in your, you are in charge of a division?
No, sir, I'm in charge of a circle.
Circle. What is the level of fake invoice in your circle?
As such, I can tell it is, almost zero, sir. Because my circle is an urban circle, and the two most are traders, automobile dealers and cement and steel.
They are prone for, the cement sector is prone for fake invoice.
It is true, sir, but this cement sector, they are distributors for a single company.
You are interested with the enforcement also?
Yes, sir, I did a lot of inspections also.
Enforcement, yes, sir. Tell me some interesting case.
Yes, sir, just... I will tell you two cases, sir, if you permit.
Mm.
One thing is regarding chit funds.
Mm.
We have inspected one chit fund sector case. There, what we have found is if the members are not paying the due amount, then the company is collecting penalty amount. But on that penalty, they are not paying GST.
Mm.
But on that penalty also, they need to pay GST.
Which law says that penalty should be subject to GST?
In GST, it is told that the act of, tolerating a mistake, the act of tolerating a mistake done by the consumer, that he hasn't paid at the time.
Mm.
So that also comes under a service.
That also comes under. Good.
So actually that is in tribunal.
Enough testing of your GST knowledge. What do you think about your state's three capital scheme? Is it good or bad? It's a foolish thing.
As such, there are both the pros and cons.
Mm.
But in my limited understanding, sir, I think it is a good step.
Because Karnool also will get then.
Sir, it is because of few reasons, sir. Firstly, Andhra has seen historically that it has lost three capitals, Chennai, Hyderabad and Karnool.
Mm.
In all the instances, it was a disadvantage because entire development is centralized.
How do you say Chennai you have lost? Tell me.
Yes, sir. Apart from that, sir, the northern part and southern part of Andhra, they are underdeveloped when compared to the middle part. We have seen that in India specifically, capitals act as growth pullers for both social and economic infrastructure. So it will lead to balanced development.
So one more enabling environment for three capital, advancement in technology.
Yes, sir, definitely. Communication, video conferencing and etc. Yeah.
Okay. Right. Last question. What is the difference between computer science and computer engineering?
So computer science basically focuses on the theoretical aspects like automata, computing, compiler design, etc. For further research. Computer engineering mainly focuses on the application part, the computer networks.
What is the difference between engineering and technology?
I think technology is a kind of science. Engineering is a kind of application to that science.
If you say information technology, biotechnology, engineering, computer engineering and computer technology, what is the difference then? Science is theory, engineering application. Now we come to technology.
Thank you.
Finally, something even. Good.
Okay. What magnitude of to perform CSR activities? Like there has been threefold criteria.
Yes.
So what is that?
And there are criteria based on the net worth, total turnover, and the profits of last 3 years. The average profits of last 3 years should be more than 5 crores, ma'am, if I'm remembering correctly. And the net worth should be more than 250 crore. And turnover more than 500 crore. I'm able to remember the numbers correctly.
You will have to check these figures. Yes, it's 500 and 1000 crore.
Oh.
Okay. Recently, there have been talks of population policy of Assam and UP. So, what is your opinion about that and on what line should be the next population policy?
Ma'am, presently the total fertility rate of India is around 2.3 and it is expected that our demographic dividend will close sooner than what we expect. So in the future, population is definitely necessary. And further coming to the specific population policy, ma'am, I think that rather than focusing on restrictive measures, I think we should focus on development and empowering women, specifically with quality education, livelihood opportunities, so that they can take decisions regarding their bodily autonomy and the number of children they need to have. Because we have seen that in the specific experience of South Indian states. So because of that, the TFR has reduced significantly. And also with respect to this population policy, there will be some unintended consequences like diocese to participate in panchayat elections, etc. So pressure on increased female feticide because of to have a male child within the 2 child limit. So I think we should rather focus on economic development and also women empowerment, along with removing the stigma about use of these contraceptives, especially.
Okay. There have been demands by various groups to be included in the tribal list. So how do you see it?
Is that because of the constitutional and statutory guarantees provided by the state, there are multiple demands to integrate them into tribes, ma'am. I think before integrating them, we need to study their socio-economic characteristics and the kind of culture they are having. Is it really a tribal culture? And do they really need the support of state for development? So in that case, if they satisfy all these conditions, then definitely we can extend the benefits, ma'am.
So what do you say?
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. How was your work experience at Indian Oil Corporation?
It was great. Actually, I was posted in a disaster recovery center in Bangalore. I worked as a part of a very experienced team. So I learned the importance of having a standby. And
so what was this role of this disaster relief department?
Actually, disaster recovery center.
Recovery center.
We have a main production data center at Gurgaon. Our site is a disaster recovery center, which will take upon operations if something happens to the main center. So the operations continue.
Can you tell me about the data localization? Data localization.
It is an initiative taken by the government so that the critical and sensitive data regarding Indian companies and Indian citizens should be stored in within India itself, especially regarding the financial data. Recently, RBI has even banned few companies like Diners Club and MasterCard, etc., because they haven't complied with these.
So, theories of evolution. Can you tell me different theories of evolution?
You said they were like out of Africa theory, where everyone has originated from African ancestors, and multiple origins theory, where there were multiple ancestors, one in Africa and another in China, etc. And there was no conclusive evidence to credit or discredit any theories. Research is still going on.
Which theory do you think, according to you, is the right one?
As such, I think out of Africa origin theory is more reliable.
Can you tell me some tribal communities which has close linkage to African tribes which is present in India?
So close engagement or resemblance?
Close resemblance and close anthropological features.
Yes, definitely the types of Andamans, they have negrito features. The Sentinelese, Ong, Jarwa.
Anything else? One hobby is really interesting, watching web series on professional fiction. What do you mean by professional fiction?
It is a particular genre where the main focus is on the professional side of the actors involved. They will showcase the kind of procedures in that profession, the kind of challenges they go through, how they will overcome them.
Can you give me some examples?
Yes, Gates Anatomy regarding medical interns, Suits regarding corporate lawyers.
So what do you watch? Which of these? You have watched both of those? Are there any Indian series which is showing professional fiction?
Yes, sir. Definitely we have Delhi crime regarding the Nirbhaya issue. Further, recently we have got Family Man regarding people working with NIA.
Can you tell me about censorship associated with OTT platforms?
Sir, as such, recently with the recent guidelines, a soft touch approach was followed, where a three-level regulatory approach was followed. At the first level, the self-censorship will be there. After that, it will be monitored by a retired judge or a person appointed. After that, censorship by the government.
There are some recent changes proposed in the censorship, and directors and filmmakers are protesting.
Yes.
Are you aware of this?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me?
It is that a power was given to government that it can order re-censorship of any movie that was already affected by the censor board.
What is your opinion on this?
Sir, I think as such, rather than going for reordering, we need to give clear rules to the censor board itself. So what all government wants to restrict? The kind of child pornography or terrorist activities promotion. So if clear guidelines was there, then I think the need of re-censorship will not arise.
Okay. Your Telugu cinema film industry is called what? Tollywood?
Tollywood.
So where is Tollywood now? Is it in Telangana or in Andhra Pradesh?
So as such, it is distributed over both the...
So Bahubali is from where?
Bahubali, as such, it was produced and the entire film was made in... pardon me. It was made in Hyderabad itself, sir. But few parts were shot in Karnool also, sir. So it was a whole Andhra film.
It's a whole Andhra.
Why? It was filmed in Hogenekal also.
Pardon me, sir.
Hogenekal Falls also.
Yes, sir. Pan-Indian film, sir. Pardon me, sir.
Okay. Yashwanta, your interview is over.
Sir.